Everyone wants to get on to the question, so I'll be relatively brief. I think we're at a turning point in our history. In my lifetime, I was born in 1945, only two elections have really changed our politics. Right, the first, I was about 6 weeks old, and the 1945 Labour government was elected, adopting a Keynesian economic policy, a pushing investment, committed to full employment, a welfare state. And the next election that changed things, of course, was Margaret Thatcher in 1979, committed to breaking the power of the unions, removing the layers of regulation on the private sector, reducing the tax burden on corporations and the highest income earners. And we were told that would unleash a wave of investment and growth. And the interesting thing about both these elections was when their opponents came to power, they carried on with the policy. The Tory government in 51 carried on with the welfare state, made no great change whatsoever. And of course, when Tony Blair got elected in 79, he broadly carried on with her policies. When she died, you may have seen him on television saying, "I thought it was my job to build on what Mrs. Thatcher had achieved rather than roll it back. I just wish the bugger had told us that when he was running for the Labour leadership." And so those two defining elections. The interesting thing is, when Mrs. Thatcher did die, The Economist devoted six pages to analysing her record. Nowhere in those six pages did they mention the growth of the economy or the level of investment. Because the defining thing, now you can look at this post-World War II world, dividing it into two 35-year-long eras effectively, that Keynesian one and the neoliberal one. In that neoliberal era, we've not achieved the levels of growth and investment we did in the Keynesian era of strong trade unions and high taxes. And even now, you've got the IMF and the World Bank saying that we need to look at the fact that the growth of inequality is holding back our economy. So I think we're at another turning point. The election in 2020 will be one where there's an absolutely clear and decisive choice. You've most certainly not read much about Jeremy Corbyn's economic strategy because the media's obsessed with whether he's going to wear a white poppy or bow to the Queen, or it's all trivia rather than focusing on that. But he's running on a basis of a massive increase in investment, both public and private, and not needing to increase taxes on ordinary people, but cracking down on Google and Starbucks and all the others that don't. We don't know how much tax evasion there is, because so much of it's illegal. But the simple reality is that it might be as much as £150 billion a year. That's equivalent to a quarter of the government's annual budget. So if you can clamp down on that tax avoidance and evasion, you don't need to increase taxes in order to fund a big expansion of healthcare, in education and so on, all of that. So I think it's going to be an absolutely fascinating period, the last chance in my lifetime for a real game-changing election. So my advice to people is get involved in politics. This is absolutely going to be a decisive few years. And I wouldn't have voted for Jeremy if I didn't think he could win. And the simple reality of this is that I do think we will win, because there's nothing looking good about the state of the British economy. I'm sorry if I drone on about economics, but it doesn't seem to me there's any point being in politics if you don't understand economics, because if you can't get the economy right, nothing else really works in the long term. You can do all sorts of nice things like, legislating to have gay marriage, but if people aren't in work, if the economy isn't growing more strongly, then slowly you're locked into a decline. And the point I end on is this. I grew up in a world where things always got better. Literally, if I think back to when I first came to Oxford to do a speech in 1981 to the Oxford Labour Club, I would have said then, I believe by now we'd be living in a social democratic heaven, like Sweden or Norway or somewhere. It never occurred to me that things would get worse, that whole communities would be left behind. And it's not just here in Britain. You look at the support for Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders in America, or Le Pen in France, or Podemos in Spain, across the Western world anyway. Ordinary people are angry that for the last 30 or more years, they've been left behind. And inequality which was halved between 1914 and 1979, is now back to being as bad as it was in 1914. And the simple fact is, if the wealth being created passes into a few hands, they just buy another bloody great yacht in Monaco. If it goes in the hands of ordinary people, they spend it in our economy, and they create jobs and they create growth. So I think this is an absolute turning point. Get involved in politics, preferably by voting for Labour.
Mr. Livingstone, thank you very much. And I just want to pick up on your belief that Labour really can win in 2020, because you and many others on the hard left claim that Corbyn and his policies are good for the Labour Party, despite seeing a decrease in the vote share in the May elections, despite seeing a really terrible showing in Scotland, which used to be a real heartland for Labour, but actually you came third to the Tories. Isn't that proof that Jeremy Corbyn really isn't electable?
Well, no. I mean, our problem in Scotland is that, I mean, the Labour Party in Scotland, on the Scottish Assembly, Scottish Parliament, was really quite conservative with a small C, and we were outflanked to the left by the SNP. In actual fact, the SNP in government is not quite as radical as it claims to be, and I do think there's a chance we can start to claw back ground in that area. Then when you look at this local elections we've just been through, the simple fact is 2012, when those seats were last contested, was our best local election result for 12 or 14 years. And it was always going to be a struggle. And of course, you've got all these Labour MPs backstabbing Jeremy day in, day out, always trying to have a diversion, all the crap about anti-Semitism and so on. Anything rather than discuss the serious political issues about what you do to rebuild our economy. And undoubtedly that has done some damage. But we held on most significantly in those parts of the English country where we actually have to do to actually win seats back at the next election. And we did best in London, which is actually, if the rest of the country had swung like London did at the general election, Ed Miliband would be in Downing Street leading a minority government. So no, I didn't support Michael Foot when he stood against Dennis Healey in 1980, because I didn't think Michael, I loved him, but he was like a wonderful academic floating above the reality of the world. He couldn't connect with people. And I wouldn't have voted for Jeremy because I want my kids to have a better life if I didn't think Jeremy could win. And he does connect me. I mean, amongst the media elite, there's all this stuff about, oh, he does so bad at Prime Minister's question. But people keep telling me on the street, it's so nice to see a man just asking sensible questions, not doing all this yaboo shit.
Well, you've repeatedly spoken about Jeremy Corbyn's mandate due to his win in the Labour leadership election and how therefore his is the voice which is most important within the Labour Party. But do you not see there being a big issue with the fact that he was elected by a few thousand people who signed up paying £3 to join the register to vote, when really the millions who voted for Labour at previous general elections certainly did not want a hard left candidate like him?
Well, if you look, the influx of new members was, I mean, a bit like what's happening with Bernie Sanders in America, that, I mean, people suddenly see, particularly young people, here's someone who will actually make our life better. And I think the decisive turning point was when Jeremy voted against the social benefit cuts, whereas Harriet Harman said the Labour Party wouldn't oppose those cuts, and that showed clearly he was different. I think he will connect. We've just got to try and focus on the economy, because if you look at the 92 general election, which everyone was surprised that Neil Kinnock didn't win, I had two factors. John Major was seen as a nicer person than Neil Kinnock, but we didn't have a coherent economic strategy. And last May, I mean, in 2015, in that election, I was in Tory marginal seats all over the country. And again, working class people, we say, what did the last Labour government do for me? And so it's not that people have turned against Labour because Jeremy's too left-wing. They turned against Labour because it did bugger all. It didn't create good jobs for ordinary people. It didn't build council housing that their kids can afford to rent. And Jeremy's up for these things.
Well, you're someone who obviously did do a lot during your own tenure as Mayor of London. So let's talk a bit about that period. And it was obviously a pretty difficult time for London, the financial crash towards the end of your tenure, the 7/7 bombings. Why did you blame Tony Blair for the 7/7 bombings?
Well, I don't blame him exclusively, but the simple fact is that, you know, he was told by our security services that if we invaded Iraq, it would make us increase our risk as a target for terrorism. And we knew. I mean, from the day of 9/11, we knew London was a target. We put a lot of effort into trying to prepare for that. We managed to prevent several attacks, and that's still happening. Part of our problem, I think, was that the four bombers that came to London weren't London-based. So our counter-terrorism unit in the Metropolitan Police, who are monitoring a lot of potential risks in London and usually arresting them before they did anything, I mean, weren't able to access that. I think we're now much better in having a national oversight of this, and it's most likely less likely to happen. But Blair knew that risk, and he decided to take it.
But you described those bombers as individuals who, and I quote, who had given their lives in protest against the Iraq invasion, despite the fact that 52 people died, over 700 were injured. Does that not make you a terrorist sympathiser?
No, just a statement of fact. Here were four young men, born and brought up in this country, went to our schools, watched our television, worked side by side with people who weren't Muslims, and sat down in a room and decided they were going to blow themselves up, even though one of them had just had their first child. And if you can't get into the thinking of terrorists, you won't defeat them. I mean, Mrs. Thatcher always depicted the IRA as merely psychopaths and criminals, and there was no politics to that. And people like myself who'd met Gerry Adams and others realised they were ready for negotiations. And if Thatcher had listened to Jeremy and myself when we came back from our meetings in the early 80s, you could have saved 1,000 lives that were lost in that 12 or 13 years before. I mean, Tony Blair was elected, and one of the great things he did was just broker that deal that brought that conflict to an end. And that's exactly the same. You've got to understand what motivates a Muslim to become a fundamentalist and be prepared to kill themselves in order to achieve a political objective.
You rather like passing off your controversial comments as statements of fact.
Yeah.
And of course, your most recent comments that Hitler was supporting Zionism, I feel that we really have to address that elephant in the room. Do you still stand by those comments?
Well, what historian doesn't? I mean, this is not a matter of opinion. I mean, when Hitler became Chancellor, he was supporting the immigration of German Jews, there were 500,000, to Israel. Not he personally, but one of his government, signed an agreement with the Zionist movement that German Jews would be moved to what is now Israel. They would be allowed to take about half their wealth. The kibbutzim in what was then Palestine would buy German goods as part of that deal. In response to that deal, he then in 1935 passed a law that said only two flags can be flown in Germany, the swastika and the Zionist blue and white banner. The Zionists asked him to change the rules about the rabbis. Rabbis in Germany preached in Yiddish. They were forced to preach in Hebrew, which was the language that the Zionist movement set up. And if you really want, you can look at, I can't remember which Nazi leader it is. It might be Himmler, I can't remember. At one point in his diary, he writes, "These are the good Jews. These are the Jews we can do business with." Now, those are just historical facts. Would you denounce someone for saying we were invaded by the Normans in 1066? Is that offensive to the French? These are statements of fact.
But do you not accept the fundamental distinction between a movement to provide a safe place for Jews to live in the wake of 6 million Jews being killed in the Holocaust and the aim of a despicable man to eradicate Jews from Europe?
Well, the question I was asked, because it was my wife's 50th birthday. I think better things to do with my day than spend all day being pursued by journalists screaming I was a Nazi sympathiser. Well, that was John Mann rather than the journalist. The simple fact is I asked the question, And the question was, was what Hitler did legal? And I pointed out there were two phases in Hitler's policy. Throughout the 1930s, it was about working with the Zionists to move Jews from Germany to Palestine. And then sometime about 1941, he went down this other road of genocide. They're two quite distinct periods. And almost everybody who's written about that period, confirms this. I mean, these were laws that were passed.
Can you not at least understand why so many people have been outraged and disgusted by your remarks, which do appear to be lauding a man who was responsible for the deaths of millions of people?
How does it laud it? It simply states this is what he did. I mean, the simple fact is, when Leni Brenner, who wrote the book about Zionism in the Age of Dictators, came to Britain in 83, this very intense bit. Loads of people like myself who knew nothing about the history of Zionism in the 30s really shocked by all of this. There were lots of meetings. People didn't say Leni Brenner was anti-Semitic, being he was Jewish himself and worked for the Jewish Guardian. It wasn't an issue at all. I put all of this in my autobiography that was published 5 years ago. No one raised it. And it was simply these embittered old Blair MPs thought, here we can actually start, screaming at Kennedy as a Nazi apologist and so on, and create a diversion around all this stuff. Does Labour have a problem with anti-Semitism? Well, I tell you this, 80 Jewish Labour Party activists sent a letter to The Guardian on the last Saturday in April saying, in all their years in the party, they'd never experienced any anti-Semitic comment or incident. And in all my years in the party, and bear in mind, the Labour Party has always had a higher proportion of Jewish MPs than any other political party in Britain. No MP, Jewish or non-Jewish, ever raised an issue saying, we have a problem with anti-Semitism, until we had this nonsense at the Oxford Labour Club with these allegations of anti-Semitism, which was more to do with whether you're going to have a Corbynite or a Blairite elected to the youth position on the executive. And we've had about six people expelled from the party who did say something anti-Semitic in websites, people who joined over the last year or so, and they were all suspended or expelled within 2 days.
But doesn't that recent spate of high-profile suspensions, including your own, throw cold water on the assertion that there really is no problem of anti-Semitism in the Labour Party?
Well, we'll see when Jack Travolta's report comes out, but literally, I've been a Labour Party member for 47 years. I've never heard an anti-Semitic comment by any party member. I've got to go back to 1970 for a racist comment when someone's complaining that why are black people singing Young, Gifted and Black? That's the last time I can remember a racist comment. I have to say I've often heard some sexist comments in the Labour Party, and we've still got to work on that.
Do you accept that anti-Semitism is still an issue in the UK, even if not in the Labour Party?
All across the world, you get anti-Semitic incidents. I just simply point to my record as mayor. Each year I was mayor, with one exception, anti-Semitic incidents declined. In Boris's first year, they went up nearly 60%. The one year in which they didn't go down was 2006, when the Israeli invasion of Lebanon led to a doubling of anti-Semitic incidents in Britain and across Europe. In London, they didn't go up, they just stopped falling. And so you actually look at my record, it's the best record of modern times, the reduction of anti-Semitic incidents in the city I was running.
Well, what is the point where legitimate criticism of Israel becomes anti-Semitism?
I mean, if I denounce the government of South Africa as corrupt beyond belief, no one's going to say I'm a racist. I denounce Cameron's government, no one says it's because I'm anti-British. And the Israeli government's approach to the Palestinians is appalling, and not since Rabin was assassinated has Israel had a prime minister with the strength of character or the vision to actually work towards the settlement. And when Israel was created 68 years ago, the idea was this would be a safe haven for the Jews of the world. I mean, is it safe? How long is it going to be before a terrorist group gets chemical or biological or even a nuclear weapon, or a local regime elects someone, or not elects, it would be a coup, wouldn't it, who is going to use weapons of mass destruction against Israel? I mean, Israel has failed to secure that security, and it isn't just a two-state solution. It needs to be a one economy. You need, in the same way that it's inconceivable you'd have a war in Western Europe now, because we created a genuine global market, Israel should be at the core of not just an economy which includes the Palestinians, but includes Jordan and Syria and Iraq, and leads the Middle East economically. That's the way you create a long-term solution.
Well, it's not just these latest anti-Semitic comments, though, because in the past you have likened a Jewish reporter to a Nazi concentration camp guard.
Well, I didn't know he was a reporter. I was just being rude to a reporter. How am I supposed to know he's bloody Jewish? And if you've got someone pursuing you down the street yelling at you at 9 o'clock at night, just being rude to them is not bad. I mean, somebody might hit him, actually, if they're doing that to somebody else.
Well, in 2012, you claimed the Conservative Party was riddled with homosexuals.
Hang on. I must have been making a joke. I've been a passionate supporter. I mean, I supported lesbian and gay rights in 1981. When I became the leader of the GLC, at a time when it was politically lethal, to be supporting homosexuality. And even in the 1987 election, Thatcher's campaign was based on saying that homosexuality was being promoted in our schools, which actually we didn't find any example of whatsoever. So, there were an awful lot of homosexuals in the Tory party that got into marriages to hide the background of that, because it was completely unacceptable. And I'm delighted we finally got a Tory leader who's brought in gay marriage and helped to change all that. But some of us were pushing that a third of a century ago.
Well, I can keep listing these incidents. You described a Labour rival as needing psychiatric help for their depression. Why do you insist on making these hideous comments about people?
I mean, I grew up in a world where if someone's rude to you, you're rude back to them. The MP who'd said that, had actually said I wasn't fit to be the co-chair of the Defence Review. And I just thought, well, bugger you, as you quoted, Charles Moore said I was the only successful socialist of modern times. To be denounced by someone you've never met, who hasn't bothered to check you, and I had responsibility for civil defence both as leader of the GLC and as mayor of London. I mean, I just thought it was offensive, so I was rude back. But that's what a working class oik from South London tends to do. I suppose if I'd gone to university, I'd be much smoother and charming like Tony Blair.
Do you not feel, though, that these episodes of controversy have undermined your legacy, the good work that you did as mayor, whether that is the congestion charge, the Oyster Card, the bid for the London 2012 Olympic Games?
Well, no, because, the contrast is there's what dominates the media. But, after this latest anti-Semitism row, I couldn't walk down the street without being stopped by people saying, don't give in. We know what you say is true. 30 years ago, you'd have had to go to the library and check. Now people can find out in 15 minutes on the internet. I'm still getting that. Three people today have stopped and said, don't give in to them. We know what you said is true. Disproportionately, actually, quite a few of those people who stopped me. One woman said, I'm Jewish. Don't these MPs read history? The establishment don't want people like me or Jeremy in positions of power, and they will do anything to stop us. When I became the leader of the GLC, Tory Central Office went round newspapers saying, I've been at a gay orgy where I've been buggered by six men in succession. Papers soon worked out that wasn't my natural predilection. The following year, they were going round saying, Special Branch had a file on my sexual activities with schoolgirls. Well, sadly, no paper ever ran with that story. I could have made a lot of money. In private, you read that Colonel Gaddafi had put $200,000 in my Swiss bank account. I was importing pills from San Francisco that changed the taste of human semen to strawberry flavour. I've had a life of lies, I just sail on, I'm not worried about what people think about me when I'm dead. I'm just worried about what I could actually do while I was in office.
You're probably aware that at the moment, Oxford is having a referendum on its membership of the National Union of Students. And at this year's NUS conference, delegates voted that the Holocaust should not be commemorated because it prioritises some genocides over others. Would you agree with that decision?
No, but I read the debate about that. There was something in that clause which, I mean, that motion, which was, the new president, the NUS, thought was wrong. No one's going to say that the Holocaust wasn't one of the greatest crimes in human history.
So it should be commemorated.
I work with the Board of Deputies of British Jews to help fund Holocaust memorial events because kids were growing up not aware of, things like that. We worked with a whole range of Jewish groups in London who were fighting anti-Semitism and so on. But I'm not going to not criticise the state of Israel for policies that I think that are brutal.
Sure, but you're the one that keeps drawing a distinction between the state of Israel and between Judaism and what happened in the Holocaust. Mm. So surely you can criticise the state of Israel and still say firmly that the Holocaust was outrageous and we should commemorate it.
And we did at County Hall on an annual basis. I found it incredibly moving watching school children who really knew nothing about it coming to that event. It often moved me to tears. The Holocaust was the greatest crime of modern times. There may have been terrible things in the past that we don't know about, but in modern history it's hard to think of a worse crime. Everyone should denounce it. But it looks to me like the new president of the NUS is being smeared as an anti-Semite in exactly the same way I've had to put up with all my life.
Well, I think we're going to open up to questions from the audience now. And could we please start with the question from the member four rows back on my right-hand side.
Thank you for very much for what we can describe as an interesting talk, to say the least. One of the things I wanted to ask you about is the Labour Party's relations with various groups. And I'm just going to very quickly clarify the actual reason why the chairman resigned was multiple allegations were made about some of the things that were sung, such as Rockets Over Tel Aviv. And the actual reason in which it all flared up was during one meeting, I heard somebody criticise Israeli Apartheid Week and one of the other members of the club say, "Oh, that's typical, they're of Jewish descent," something which is quite concerning. Now, elucidating that for wider communities, what do you think the Labour Party can do to better engage this and a lot of other ethnic minority groups now and in the future?
Well, the Labour Party has always basically been the vehicle for minorities. When the great wave of Jewish migrants arrived at the end of the 19th century, they were desperately poor, they were solidly Labour or communist in many cases. As each new wave of migrants comes, that happens. Some then, their children or grandchildren go on to vote Conservative because they do better. Others remain poor and stay absolutely solidly committed to Labour. And I think we've been very good as a Labour Party in challenging racism. If you look back, some of the private things written by Labour ministers in the 1945 Labour government are pretty awful. They sometimes use the word nigger and so on. The last 2 years of the wartime coalition, in which Labour was there, they instituted a policy that led to the death of between 3 million and 5 million Bangladeshis who starved to death because Britain was removing rice from what's now Bangladesh, using it to sustain the cities in India which were doing wartime production. There are a lot of awful things in our past, but certainly from the 1960s, when people like Roy Jenkins, he was no Trotskyist at all, really started challenging, we passed legislation tackling racism and so on, and moved on to sexism and legalised homosexuality. I think it's always been the Labour Party at the forefront of these social changes. And eventually the Tory party comes along and catches up.
Thank you. We'll go to the question from the member right at the back of the room on my left-hand side.
I'd like to thank you for your interesting speech.
You'll have to speak up. I've left my hearing aid at home.
I'd like to thank you for your excellent speech. I just wanted to ask you why you think so much of popular anger has been capitalised by the right, Trump, etc., and by nationalists, such as in Scotland, rather than the left, which it used to be?
Well, I mean, across the world, there's this anger that ordinary people have just not seen any improvement in their life, and many people have seen their life, I mean, dramatically worse. I mean, I left school, every boy got a job in a working class school in Brixton in 1962. Every boy got a job. I didn't know an unemployed person until I was 28 or 29. And people, even young people, are aware that their parents had a better life. And this anger can go into two directions. In France, it's gone in to the National Front under Le Pen. In America, it's going both to Bernie Sanders and to Donald Trump. Here, some of it's gone behind Nigel Farage. Others have come in behind Jeremy Corbyn. I think across the Western world, there's this perception that this last 30 years, right, we elected Blair, the Americans elected Clinton, but nothing much changed. They carried on with the policies of Reagan and Thatcher, and those have led to a diminution of the quality of life of ordinary people. I think we're just lucky in Britain that, you know, Nigel Farage isn't a fanatical fascist like you've got in France. I always get on quite well when we have a drink in the pub and things like that. We're a bit better off here. We're not on the verge of having a fascist government like you might have, or you may be on the borderline of having in Austria, or extreme right parties as we've seen in Poland. I just think we are, of all the Western democracies, I think Britain is the most advanced in terms of tackling ethnic minorities, different religions. Not perfect, but I mean, there was an opinion poll in 2007. Asked Muslims in Paris and Muslims in London, do you feel French or British? 45% of Muslims in Paris felt French, 90% of Muslims in London felt British. And you actually look, if I'd, back in the 1960s, come home with a black girlfriend, the whole street would have been talking about it. My first grandchild is mixed race, no one registers it. I think we've come a long way, not that we haven't got a way still to go, but very good indeed.
We'll go to the question from the member in the green shirt.
Since you have done lots of work for the public services, especially in London, do you think we should renationalise the public services? And do you think it would be possible in this day and age?
Well, it's quite interesting. Adam Smith, who was no lefty, he wrote that no monopoly should ever be in private hands. And the only privatisation that hasn't seen us ripped off has been British Airways, because they had competitors. If British Airways had increased their fares or reduced the quality of their service, we'd have got a European or American airline. But with all the others, even when it's not a monopoly, but it's, you know, like, you know, half a dozen major energy firms, they've all rigged it. So we've got horrendous energy prices, horrendous fares. And the Thatcher line was, it would, you know, you'd have a big boost in investment once these things go into the private sector. No. I mean, the subsidy that the British government is paying to the rail companies is four times in real terms the subsidy we used to give to British Rail when it was in public ownership. Now, yes, you can bring them back, but you don't have to. You can just regulate them properly. I mean, the big boost in the transformation of the bus system in London, in my mayoralty, I didn't bring any of them bus companies into public ownership, but we regulated them properly about the rate, the service level they have to provide, the fares. We determined which routes they run and so on. So you don't have to nationalise things. Some things it would work better if you did. I do think we need one national rail network. But you know, as we've demonstrated, the bus companies, either very tight regulation, which the bus companies all campaign against in the rest of the country. If you go back to when the buses were privatised, there were 2 billion bus journeys a day, 2 billion bus journeys a year outside London and 1 billion in London. Now it's 2 billion a year in London and 1 billion outside. And London was the only place where the bus companies weren't subject to proper regulation, because the Tories recognise it could be a disaster if London ground to a halt.
And the question on the third row in the aisle.
Thank you for your speech. I just want to pick up on one point on you saying the situation of the economy now being problematic. Given under the coalition and Tory-led governments, we've had record job growth, low inflation, and reduction in the deficit, how much better could Labour have done potentially, and how high are your expectations given for an economy to run after a terrible global economic crash?
Thank you. I mean, I don't think this government's record has been any good at all, because I mean, Gordon Brown's response to the banking crisis was right. A big increase in public sector investment. It went, well, before Thatcher was elected, Labour and Tory governments spent about 5.5% of GDP on public sector investment. Thatcher cut it to 1%. Heroically, Blair lifted it to 1.5%. And then under Gordon Brown, he pushed it up to 3.5%. And if you go back and look, in that year before Cameron won the election, our growth rate was heading towards something close to 3%, at least 2.5%. I mean, Cameron got in and Osborne, they massively cut public sector investment. We were pushed back into recession. And then by 2012, when they were beginning to worry about the forthcoming election, they did start to increase spending, but it was around housing. Not investment in building new housing, but in boosting the housing market. And so, we haven't seen the Attlee government, when it was elected, faced a debt in real terms 2.5 times the size that we had after the banking crisis. They didn't go for austerity. They went for full employment, put people back in work. They're off benefits, they're paying tax. And almost all the jobs being created are low skill, low wage and insecure. There is no future for an advanced capitalist economy going low skill, low tech, low investment. And that's why we limp along and people feel so angry. Those aren't good jobs. They're insecure. If you actually look, we've now got our worst ever balance of trade deficit, 7% of our GDP. And that's because half of all our exports are in manufacturing. And we've seen our manufacturing, both under Thatcher and Blair, dramatically reduced. It's now about 9% of our GDP. And it's wonderful, the growth of the service economy, yes, but it's manufacturing is the core of your exports. Germany exports 5 times what we do to China. And therefore, Germany's emphasis on investment, rebalancing our economy, is absolutely essential.
Thank you. We'll go to the question from the gentleman in the third row.
Thank you, Mr. Livingstone. I had the privilege of being at university with your ex-colleague, Mr. Kinnock. And in the Students' Union, there was complete freedom of speech. Hmm. What you've suffered in the last 30 days clearly shows how much that has been eroded. What do we need to do to preserve this freedom of speech that we've got now?
Well, I remember when I became an MP, I said lots of things about Ireland which caused great controversy. One of them was accusing MI5 of overseeing the sexual abuse at the Kinkora boys' home. I was shouted down by Tory MPs at the time. I can't remember what it was I said about something to do with Ireland. And we had a meeting of the PLP where several Labour MPs said, Livingstone's got to be stopped from saying these sorts of things. And Kinnock got up and closed that debate saying, Ken Livingstone has the right to be wrong. Now, Kinnock loathed me, but he actually recognised the importance of that. And then along came Blair, and everyone's told, you've got to say this, this is the line. Whole groups tell us this is what people want to hear. And that's why, whenever I've gone through these great waves of people screaming, I should apologise for being rude to that reporter, or apologise for saying, Hitler had supported Zionism in the 1930s, I have never given in. And you just got to stick there and go through it. And Peter Hitchens, who writes in the Daily Mail, is horrendously right-wing. During the aftermath of that row with the porter, said Livingstone's a vile, repellent person, but he's right not to apologise. And I think it's almost like we've created an apology industry. I mean, endlessly now people demanding apology for this, that, and the other thing. I mean, you've got a right to say what you believe. I don't think you've got a right to advocate racism or violence, but you've got a right to say what you believe, and we should just stick with it and not give in to it, because I managed to survive 35 years of this crap.
Thank you. We'll go to the question from the member about four rows back on my left-hand side.
Hello. Thank you for your speech. I'm a Londoner as well, and I'm also part of the Labour Party. So I'm really happy about your hopes for 2020 for the Labour Party. But I wanted to ask, coming to the EU, so those who say we should leave say if we don't, there's going to be an economic crisis. And those who say we should remain say if we don't, there's going to be an economic crisis. So basically, something bad's going to happen with the economy. So if something bad does happen with the economy, what does the Labour Party need to do to actually get the trust of the people that we can handle the economy? Because the Conservative government obviously has, you know, the long-term economic plan. Mm. What does the Labour Party need to do to show that we can handle an economy that might be going down?
Well, it's quite because our problem on the referendum is that the people who want to leave are absolutely passionate and they will go out and vote. And the people who want to stay in, like myself or Jeremy, it's on the basis that we think it'll be worse if we leave, but we aren't prepared to say that this is a wonderful system. It's a ghastly bureaucracy. It should be democratised properly. We should do away with the commission. The Euro MPs who are elected should actually run the damn thing. And there's a lot of change you need to make. So with all those qualifications, you don't quite get the enthusiasm and passion of those people saying we can control our own borders again and so on. I mean, and all the predictions by both sides, I mean, are predictions. All I would say is, look at the history of the last 60 years. And before the EU came, well, the common market came into being in the late 1950s, 16% of Germany's imports came from Britain. They then fell to 8% by the time we joined the European Union. They're now back up at 18%. Because for all this crap you get from some toys saying, we'll be able to do more trade with India and China, the bulk of everybody's trade is with their neighbours. And I will continue to, you know, make the same sort of case that the former finance minister of Greece, Yanisakis, is doing for a proper democratisation of Europe. But, I mean, if someone could prove to me we'd better off leaving, I'd vote to leave. But no one has effectively done that. If we do vote to leave, well, I should imagine Cameron will be gone within a week and then we'll be under the horrors of Boris. And, you know, we've got to demonstrate we've got a coherent alternative. And the single thing I'd say about this is John McDonnell, our Shadow Chancellor, was my Chair of Finance when I was leader of the GLC. Every year he produced a balanced revenue budget, never a penny of borrowing, because it's illegal to do that in local government. But you actually look at borrowing. Since Thatcher came to power in these 36 years, there have only been 5 years when a government didn't borrow to cover the revenue budget. Two under Nigel Lawson and three under Gordon Brown. All the other governments, I mean, budget has been borrowing about 2% a year usually to cover the revenue deficit and relying on inflation to erode that. Our problem now is effectively there is no inflation and therefore the scale of our debt isn't coming down. The thing about John McDonnell is he's obsessed with detail and he will produce a proper economic strategy to lift us out of this. That's why they won't ever interview him about the economy.
Thank you. We'll go to the member three quarters of the way back on my left-hand side.
Hi, Mr. Livingstone. So you said quite a few times that you don't believe there's a problem with anti-Semitism in the Labour Party, despite Naz Shah and yourself being suspended and quite a few other members. So if you don't believe in apologies, at least, for what you say, do you at least understand the anger from so many Jewish people like myself when we believe that there's a problem with anti-Semitism in the Labour Party, and then a leading Labour member like yourself comes along and not only dismisses the problem, but perpetuates it with such ill-timed and inappropriate comments, being kind at least, and says there's nothing wrong with the anti-Semitism in the Labour Party. Do you at least understand the anger from people like myself towards that?
Well, I mean, as I said, I mean, I've been in the Labour Party 47 years, never heard an anti-Semitic comment. I mean, those 80 Labour Party members who are Jewish in that letter to the Guardian say they'd never, in all their collective hundreds of years, heard anything anti-Semitic. And as a party, which has always had disproportionately larger proportion of MPs who are Jewish, up until the row at the Oxford Labour Club, no Labour MP, Jewish or non-Jewish, had ever raised the issue of anti-Semitism in the Labour Party. And I think this has been largely manufactured by people trying to undermine Jeremy Corbyn. We have had half a dozen people who've joined in the big influx of members who've said things which clearly are anti-Semitic. They've all been expelled. My problem is, I mean, I should never have come into politics. I've always believed in telling the truth. If someone asks me a question, I answer it. I was asked, was what Hitler did lawful? I just referred to the historical facts, those two phases of Hitler's policy. I did it in under four. I mean, I didn't go onto the radio to start talking about Hitler. I was defending Naz. And I went and I worked for Naz in the election she had against George Galloway. Nothing suggested to me there was a shred of anti-Semitism. Some of the things she said were over the top and insensitive, but she's not anti-Semitic. And I was just doing a load of interviews, defending the Labour Party in these allegations. If we find someone who's anti-Semitic, they will be expelled. But you can't expel someone for saying the truth. No one would be expelled from the Labour Party for saying, 2 + 2 = 4. And suspending me for actually saying, a simple historical fact is, I think, really damaging. But that's the bureaucracy poor old Jeremy's inherited. It's not Jeremy's decision, it's the bureaucrats. And they came under all this pressure from the old hardline right-wing Blairites demanding I be suspended. I look forward to the hearing where I actually say, is there anything I said here that isn't true? And it would be interesting if they did expel me. It'd be interesting how a court would then actually deal with that.
Thank you. We'll go to the member about halfway back in the aisle on my right-hand side.
Thank you. You mentioned that in 2020 we will face a focal point, like a major decision, and that Labour will win because Labour is more strong on the point of like creating investment because of the redistribution, and that actually people should have money, like people who will spend the money should have the money. But don't you think that in the current situation, when you have deflation in the economy, then the people are actually less likely to spend the money if they're given more money, they're like more likely to save, and it's actually the not only the corporations, but actually the accumulation of the capital is necessary to provide for the investment, and that probably the better way to go on with incentivizing more investment is actually less taxation and less redistribution, and probably we should consider like larger projects like infrastructural projects and social investment on the part of the government as well, not only on the part of the corporations.
I'd point to the success of London. I got a huge amount of investment into upgrading our transport system, and once that had happened, we then had a wave of investment, a lot of it construction, a huge growth of the London economy. London is the only region in the whole of Europe that matches American levels of productivity and competitiveness. One of the big factors is the wave of migrants that have come, because a migrant is twice as likely to have a degree as a domestic, a British resident. But also that investment, I was told when I became mayor, if we couldn't modernise our transport system, firms would move to Paris or Brussels. So investment is that key. You can see it on the Netflix website. There's a thing called Social Economic Bulletin, which I started producing in 1990. And we constantly emphasise the importance of investment. And part of our problem is now, you see the debate about there's the retail side of banking and the investment side of banking. But they use investment, not to describe investing in modern infrastructure or upgrading a firm. Most of what now passes for investment is really dodgy property speculation and other things abroad. And so I'd restructure our tax system. So I'd cut out a lot of the tax benefits for a whole range of things companies are doing, but mostly have 100% tax rebate on genuine investment in modernising a British firm. that, I mean, I would start to really rebuild our economy. I'd also up the minimum wage to the living wage a lot more rapidly than this government's doing, so that, you know, it encourages people to come back into work. And also that you put money in people's pockets, they do spend it. I mean, that, and that's now the line being taken by the IMF and the World Bank, who aren't a load of revolutionary lefties, for God's sake. They all recognise the global economy is, you know, particularly the Western economies, are really stuck in a sort of rut.
We'll go to the question from the member towards the back on my right-hand side.
Hi. There are many questions. Sorry, there are many questions that I would like to ask you, but there's one in particular. On that fateful day for you, on Thursday the 28th of April, where you had many interviews, you had one interview with the Daily Politics show where you said, I'm quoting here, about anti-Semitism in the Labour Party, I've never heard anyone say anything anti-Semitic. I've heard a lot of criticism of Israel, I think blowing these two things, anti-Semitism and criticism of Israel, undermines the importance of anti-Semitism, because a real anti-Semite doesn't just hate the Jews in Israel. They hate their Jews and their Jewish neighbours in Golders Green or Stoke Newington. So what you seem to be saying here is that a real anti-Semite doesn't just hate the Jews in Israel, they hate the Jews in the UK too. But you seem to be strangely implying that a critic of Israel does just hate the Jews in Israel, which obviously I don't agree with at all. But I wanted to ask you, do you identify with this, Ken? Do you just hate the Jews in Israel, but not the ones in the UK?
Well, Gazi, when I was a guest of the Israeli Labour Party in 1986, after Mrs. Thatcher abolished the Jews, it was the first foreign trip I made, and I was stopping on kibbutzim and other things, and at that stage there was a lot more progressive bloc in Israel. It was possible to see a compromise coming. I mean, Israeli politics has moved much farther to the right, literally since the assassination of Rabin. And, you know, the simple fact is that criticising a government is not the same as racism. I think the real problem is that the Israel lobby, which is very well organised, particularly in the United States, anyone who criticises Israel gets accused of being anti-Semitic. That diminishes the importance of real anti-Semitism. And the genuine anti-Semite doesn't give a sod about it's just about Jews in Israel. It's the Jews here in Britain. I used to represent Stoke Newington, which has got the largest Jewish community in Britain, very strongly Orthodox. I had a very good working relationship with them. I always found it quite interesting because a lot of them were strongly critical of Israel and didn't even support the continuation of an Israeli state. Now, if I said that, I'd be accused of anti-Semitism. But you couldn't accuse the local rabbis that were saying that. And just, we should stop blurring these issues. Criticise a government, that is not the same as being anti-Semitic. You actually read the stuff that people write, racists write about black people or Muslims or Jews. It's horrendous. It's not relating to government policies. It's a fear of racial mixing. Hitler's obsession with Jews was he feared that the Jewish community, those 500,000 Jews in Germany, would undermine the racial purity of the Germans. There aren't many people in Britain who have those sort of fears about interracial marriage, but there was nothing unique about that. When President Kennedy was elected in 1960, only 10% of Americans believed interracial marriage should be legal, and it was still illegal for someone in California to marry someone of Oriental descent. And it's now 70% of Americans believe interracial marriage should be legal. It does worry you about the other 30%.
I think we've got time for a couple more questions. can we go to the question from the member about halfway down on my left-hand side? Yeah.
Hiya. Thank you for your speech. There was a short documentary about Jeremy Corbyn posted on the Vice website this morning. And in it, he was interviewed and asked about your comments on Hitler and Zionism. And he was asked what he thought the problem with those comments were. And the main gist of what he replied was he thought they were inappropriate. He never said they were anti-Semitic. Did Jeremy Corbyn actually want to suspend you from the Labour Party? Did he think you should be suspended? or is he just bowing to the public pressure, the media pressure, and the Labour Party pressure?
Now, the problem is that when I was on Labour's NEC under Neil Kinnock in the late 1980s, about once a year, we had a disciplinary issue come up. Now, Blair's legacy created a compliance unit. When I was on the NEC meetings, there'd be about 50 cases under investigation any one time. And it'd become like an industry within. And it's not that, I mean, Blair wasn't interested, he just dumped that on the party officials. So Jeremy was told I was being suspended by party officials who are not elected. And I think this is a mistake. The Labour Party should say it's either the leader or the elected members on Labour's NEC decide these disciplinary issues. We had the ridiculous situation. A Jewish woman was suspended for drawing a comparison with the slave trade and the Holocaust. She's now been reinstated. Jeremy had no say in this. And if you recall last year, one of the people Jeremy appointed to his staff was suspended by the party machine without Jeremy even being told about it. So I think this is one of the changes we've got to make in the structure of the Labour Party, bring it back to being democratic as it was before Tony Blair introduced a sort of North Korean approach to running things.
And we will go to the question at the end of that row by the fireplace.
Hey, thank you for your speech. Just within the context of the upcoming EU referendum, is it not time for us on the left to rediscover our kind of historical energy and make the case for a Brexit in the context of European-wide austerity, the treatment of Greece, issues around TTIP? I know kind of Jeremy historically has voiced concerns about the European Union, but it seems that it's very much the right and the scaremongering and the anti-immigrant rhetoric that's winning out in that field, when it really, well, in my opinion anyway, should be the home of the left. What do you think about that?
Well, Jeremy and myself both voted to leave in the referendum in 75. I wasn't certain it was the right decision. I had some doubts. But, I mean, now we live in a world which has generally got a global economy. I mean, back in 1975, no one would ever have assumed that China would almost equal America in terms of its economic strength. And it's all very well, these toys saying, well, we're the fifth largest economy in the world, which is true. But, I mean, between America and China and the EU, that's almost two-thirds of the global economy. And none of the other great powers, India and China, do not want to have to negotiate a separate deal with us. They see us as in part of that great bloc. So the world's moved on, and we can't just retreat into our own little borders. The world will continue to be more open and more global, and more people will move, whatever we try and do about it. We do need to change the EU. We do need to, one of the reasons why I would want us to stay in was I believe Britain should veto this new North Atlantic Trade and Investment Pact. I mean, it's outrageous. Just shifts more power to corporations. But if we weren't in and the EU agreed it, America would just demand we complied with it, or they wouldn't do a trade deal with us. So we have some influence in the EU. We have quite considerable influence in the EU. And if we give that up, we would be just a marginal player.
Thank you. And we'll go to the question in the third row.
You've mentioned that a lot of the things you say are taken out of proportion a lot of the time by the media especially. Mm. Do you believe that the media might be inherently biased?
Oh. it was always bad. If you go back, 1906, the Daily Mail headline was Jews bring crime and disease to Britain. Then they moved on to the Irish, then the Caribbeans, then it was the Muslims and the Romanians. Fear sells papers and hatred sells papers, I'm afraid. And it's been a disaster. The other problem we've got is two-thirds of the papers we read are owned by four billionaires, all of whom are tax dodging. The Barclay brothers who own the Telegraph, Rothermere who owns the Mail, and of course Murdoch's empire. And they're not going to do anything to allow ordinary people to read the truth about what Jeremy is saying about the economy. That's why it's all about, is he going to wear a white poppy? Is he going to bow to the Queen? Now the big row about anti-semitism, they will do anything over the next 4 years to prevent any serious debate. And I just think you can't have a proper functioning democracy in which a few billionaires control so much of the media. I think, like the BBC and like ITV and so on, they should be independently regulated, and we shouldn't allow billionaires to determine what appears in them, because they do control it.
I'm afraid that's all we have time for this evening. Could you please remain in your seats whilst we leave the room and join me in thanking Ken Livingstone.